All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to BARKS Podcast. It's Thursday, August 22nd, 2019, and we're here with guest Tabitha Kucera, who I will shortly introduce to the show. Now, we're going to be chatting about kitten socialization, so it's going to be really, really great show. You're going to learn lots of things. Okay, but before we get started, I'd just like to talk a little bit about today's show sponsor, and it's Dog Biz. So, are you tired of starting training classes with six students and finishing with three? Can't get your puppy class students to take basic manners? Maybe you're just tired of inconsistent income. The Dog Biz team can help you solve these headaches so you and your students can enjoy the best classes in town, yours. Join them for the new Dog Biz University class, the best classes in town, and it's starting September 17th. All you need to do is visit dogbizsuccess.com/best classes. So that's dogbizsuccess.com/best classes, and you can use the promotion code best classes PPG and you'll get $25 off your registration. So we encourage you to go ahead and do that. Now on with today's show. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Tabitha for those of you that don't know her. Tabitha Kucera is the owner of Chirrups and Chatter Cat Behavior Consulting and Training and Positively Pawsitive Dog Behavior Consulting and Training in Cleveland, Ohio. She's a certified cat behavior consultant through the International Association of Behavior Consultants. She's a Karen Pryor Academy Certified Training Partner, and she's a Level 3 Fear-Free and Low Stress Handling Certified Registered Veterinary Technician. Tabitha is also the co-chair of PPG's Feline Committee and a board member of the Together Initiative for Ohio Community Cats. And she's the president of the Society of Veterinary Behavior Technicians. So without further ado, Tabitha, hello and welcome to BARKS Podcast.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
An absolute pleasure. Thank you for taking time out of your day to join us, because we know, as everybody, you're very busy. So many, many thanks. And we're actually going to be talking about your upcoming presentation for PPG, which I believe is taking place on September 3rd. And yes, your presentation is called Hiss to Purr, Kitten Socialization. So if somebody wants to actually register for your presentation, they can go along to the Pet Professional Guild website and they can register there to listen to that live presentation. Is the presentation going to be an hour or is it an hour and a half? I'm not sure of that actually, Tabitha.
90 minutes. So the hour
it's
and a half.
90 minutes. So it's an hour and a half. Brilliant. Excellent. So I'm going to encourage everybody. You're going to get a little bit of an insight here, but if you want the in-depth information, obviously we're not going to give everything away in this half an hour podcast. We're going to keep quite a few things back. And so, yes, Tabitha is going to be chatting a little bit today about kitten socialization. You're all familiar with the puppy socialization, but I guess many of you don't know about kitten socialization. So I do encourage you, as well as listening to this podcast, please do register for the webinar. So, Tabitha, before I get going and start asking you some questions about kitten socialization, can you tell me a little bit, and everybody else a little bit, about Chirrups and Chatter, and also Pawsitive, I'm trying to pronounce it correctly here, and the services that you offer. And you can now correct me on my awful pronunciation. I apologize.
Oh,
for that.
You're doing great.
Thank you.
I have a cat and dog behavior consulting business. And I offer in-home behavior consulting and training for everything from fear aggression to what is really common in cats, house soiling, redirected aggression. It's great because I get to go into homes and offer training and consulting, as well as preventative care services. So I have happy vet visit packages because as a veterinary technician, positive veterinary visits are something that's really important to me. And there's a lot we can do to set our pets up for success at the vet and give them some tools to help veterinary visits be easier. So I offer that as well as kitten and puppy socialization packages as well. And I also do educational workshops and seminars on everything from fear-free and low-stress handling to preventing house soiling and feline and canine body language.
Wow, you are one busy lady.
So much to do.
Yes, that's a massive checklist there of different things. So do you work equally with the cats and the dogs, or do you find that more time is spent on one species than the other?
More recently, I actually have been working with both species about the same, because I am thankful to work with a lot of local veterinarians in my area. But to start, I was seeing a lot more cats, because unfortunately, there just aren't as many resources for cats in general. And I'm the only certified cat behavior consultant in Ohio currently. So I still see quite a lot of cats, but thankfully I get to see a lot of dogs too, because it is okay to love both.
Absolutely true. And I know a lot of people do have both cats and dogs, and a lot of people do struggle actually, just because of the reason you said that there are many of us that work with dogs, but there aren't that many people, especially people like yourself who have actually got qualifications, you know, you're a certified behaviorist, that can work with the cats.
Yeah, it's getting better. I mean, education in the veterinary field as well as the shelter field, and we're getting a lot more resources. It's getting better. I like to focus on the positive.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think it's getting better, both, like you said, for the cats and actually for the dogs. And also, you know, you've talked just a little bit about fear-free practices there. I think that's such a great initiative in well, it started off in the States, but it is actually worldwide, isn't it? The fear-free veterinary practices, etc. Okay, can you tell us a little bit, actually, before we really get going, about anybody who's listening in, about what fear-free, being a fear-free veterinary technician, actually, what sort of things you do?
Oh, yeah, of course. So being fear-free and low-stress handling certified, we've been really great in the veterinary field at taking care of animals' physical needs, like you're ill, let's get you feeling better. But we haven't been as great at addressing animals' underlying emotional needs. And sometimes those are forgotten when it comes to getting the physical things we need. And thankfully, with fear-free and low-stress handling, we're learning ways to set up the environment from a cat or dog's perspective to make things less stressful and really address their emotional well-being as well as their physical well-being.
Excellent. And if somebody would like to know more about fear-free practices, is there somewhere that they can go to find out a little bit more about that?
Yes, they could go to fearfreepets.com, and you can even find, they have a lovely directory where you can throw your zip code in and find a fear-free certified practice or professional. And it's actually take your cat to the vet day, which is a huge thing for me. So it's a great time to look up a local fear-free certified professional to get your cat in for that annual veterinary visit if you haven't already.
Excellent. Thank you, Tabitha. That's fantastic. Okay, so now on with the main topic of today's podcast, which is going to be kitten socialization. So my first question, and you may think it's a bit of a strange question, because you probably take the answer to this question for granted, but I'm sure many people don't know. What is socialization?
That is a very great question. So socialization is just the process of preparing a dog or cat to enjoy interactions and be comfortable with animals, people, places, and activities. So in many cases, it involves introducing a kitten to a variety of stimuli, which can be a wheelchair, a guy with a hat, a vet hospital, different experiences that they'll experience in their life. And you teach them that those things in life will be safe, which helps them handle life in general better.
Okay, so most people, I'm going to say most people, perhaps not most, but a lot of people understand socialization as just being about introducing an animal to another animal, maybe of the same species. So what you're saying, and I know many professionals already know this, but is that it goes beyond that.
Yes, very much so. So in my kitten kindergarten classes, I actually have toddlers, like children in my classes, as well as dogs who are well socialized and comfortable with cats in my kitten kindergarten classes to expose them to a variety of different types of stimuli that they'll most likely experience at some point in their life and make it positive to start. Because it's usually as kittens, they tend not to have a lot of negative experiences already. So if I can first present those things as positive, especially during that key socialization period, it really makes a difference for them.
Okay, so what are some of the other goals of socialization? I understand that obviously it can make a massive impact on the kitten's life and also actually on the whole family's life, can't it? But what are some of the main goals?
So the main goals, if I had to simplify it, would be for the kitten to approach you and others without fear, so choose to approach you, for the kitten to seek attention from people by approaching them, exposing them to a variety of people, as well as having the kittens associate potential fearful situations with positive experiences. So the things that I commonly see cats be fearful of, vet visits, carriers, nail trims, car rides, harness training, all that fun stuff. So we work to help the things that most cats experience as fearful as positive right from the start.
Excellent. And how do you go about making sure that the encounters are positive, Tabitha?
So that's a really good question. So socialization, of course, involves introducing them to a variety of stimuli. But the biggest part of socialization is when we do those things, we have to verify that the situations are 100% positive and pleasant experiences for them, which sometimes we can't control everything. So generally what we do is we set up a controlled, relaxed environment. Like, for example, in my kitten kindergarten class, I only have well-socialized dogs who are relaxing on a mat with a Kong while the cats are around them. And we also really focus on the kitten's body language to make sure that they're below threshold or not showing signs of fear or stress. Because if I'm exposing them to things and they are showing those subtle signs, which often don't get noticed, we're actually flooding the kittens versus exposing them to things positively. So flooding being, hey, you're afraid of something, I'm going to put you in front of that full force and you're going to get used to it, which unfortunately doesn't commonly work out. Usually it results in the animals being a lot more fearful of that stimuli.
Okay, so it's, from what you've just said then, it is very important to understand the kitten's body language. What would some of the signs of fear, anxiety or stress be in a kitten's body language, let's say?
So some of the more subtle signs are, we see a lot of displacement behaviors in kittens. So those behaviors that they might perform normally, like in it's a behavior they do usually, but it's taken out of context. So for example, the cat may be yawning a lot, but not just woke up. The cat may be lip licking or blinking a lot. We see a lot of frozen in fear. So you'll see the kitten approach something, maybe freeze for a second, and then continue to check it out. Now, if they stay frozen for longer than a second, that's usually a pretty big sign of stress, as well as the dilated eyes. Because we like to see those nice, beautiful almond-shaped pupils in kitties and eyes, but as they get more fearful or aroused, they become more round and their eyes become more dilated and just more stiff in general. Since the blood flow goes to the musculature with fight or flight, we see these cats stiffen up. We might see a little piloerection, so hair standing up on their shoulders and back, because the Halloween kitty is not a very common thing, and hopefully that's not something you're seeing, but that's what we always associate with piloerection. But commonly, there's just some slight piloerection on the shoulders, maybe the tail, that indicates to us, hey, this is a little too much for this kitten. Let's either move that trigger or whatever that stimuli is farther away, or move the kitten farther away, or completely start over with something that's less stressful for the kitten.
Excellent. That was a really good description, actually. And I'm sure many people that are listening in who perhaps mainly work with dogs would recognize some of those signs, because many of them were actually similar to the signs that we've seen in dogs, weren't they? Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for that. Okay. So you've told me a little bit about socialization and some of the goals of socialization. What are the effects of poor socialization, or maybe even no socialization?
Yeah, unfortunately, it's very common that cats don't receive socialization, and it results in a lot of pretty severe things, such as cats being euthanized, cats being relinquished to shelters, and in many cases, the cat will have a behavioral issue and the clients don't even reach out to a vet or a cat behavior consultant, and they just open their door, which is where we see so many community cats and cats from other situations where people just let them out because they're like, we didn't know what to do. And when cats aren't socialized, as you can imagine, things are more fearful and stressful for them, which commonly results in behavioral issues such as not using the litter box, maybe scratching something that they weren't supposed to scratch, destructive behaviors, because that's the other big part of kitten socialization, especially kitten kindergarten, that I really love, is not just teaching the kitten, hey, new things are safe, we're watching you, we got you, but also teaching the owners what appropriate cat behavior is. Like, hey, cats do need to scratch. This is how you can prevent them from scratching things you don't want them to. This is an appropriate litter box setup. Cats don't show pain, so annual veterinary visits are super important. Things like that. So it really helps to set the owners up for success, because in many cases with cats, a lot of the behavioral issues are preventable. Just owners don't know, because there's not as many cat behavior resources. So when their cat starts not using the box, they might think their cat's spiteful, or some of these other common myths that I hear. And if you think your cat's spiteful, you're going to just open the door versus what the cat's actually dealing with, which is stress and or a medical issue. And then that cat's never going to get help.
Right. And that's obviously a very sad situation. What would you recommend somebody does if they think that their kitten is maybe under-socialized, or that they haven't been able to socialize their kitten, and they don't have, for example, the resource of a certified cat behavior consultant or a kitten kindergarten nearby? What are some of the things that they themselves could do?
There's a lot of great resources out there. It's getting better. But usually I am a big fan of clicker training cats, because clicker training is just a great way to build confidence in the cat, strengthen the human animal bond with the cat. And then also, it's fun and enriching, of course, but it helps to teach them some things that, like, for example, if you don't want them on your counters, using clicker training, that's a really easy thing to resolve. And then you can understand that cats can learn, because unfortunately, that's something I commonly hear way too often, that cats can't learn, which is another reason why I think I see so many cats in shelters and clients opening doors, because if you don't think your cat can learn, when they're having a problem, you're just like, forget it. So even reaching out to checking out some clicker training resources and understanding kitten body language is huge. And there's tons of resources online for kitten and cat body language, because then you can notice those in your own cat. And if you see signs of fear or stress, you can be like, okay, I'm going to stop petting you before you scratch me. You stared at my hand and your tail started swishing. That means you're a little uncomfortable. I'm going to stop petting you now. Versus what we usually do is we don't notice those subtle signs, and then we're like, the cat scratches out of nowhere, which is not the case in most cases. So I would say doing your best to learn feline body language and searching for a kitten kindergarten class in your area. And if there isn't one, bringing it up to your veterinarian that this is something you're really interested in, to get the word out that, hey, this is important. This is something we want as clients. And a lot of even dog trainers can have kitten socialization classes at local vets, but raising awareness will get us more resources for sure.
And you've mentioned it several times now. So can you tell me what exactly is kitten kindergarten?
So kitten kindergarten is, like you mentioned at the beginning of the show, we're all familiar with puppy socialization and puppy socialization classes, where you have these classes that are set up for puppies so they're less stressful. You're controlling the environment. You might have some calming music. You'll have some barriers. You're observing the dog's body language. It's the same thing with kittens. So basically, it's usually between 2 to 5 classes. It's a newer concept for a lot of people. So most of my kitten kindergarten classes currently are 2. But as it gets more popular, I would love to have 5. But basically what we do in those classes is in my class, we have a handling station, a training station, and then a play station. And these kittens learn how to play with other kittens. They learn what appropriate play is, because that's something that's really important for cats, because they're prey and predator animals. They have to kill things and attack things, but they shouldn't be your hands or feet. So we teach owners what appropriate play looks like, how to do it, what your cat needs. And then when it comes to the handling, that's a huge thing, because so many cats don't go to the vet because of the amount of stress that they go through. And clients are coming from a good place. They don't like to see their cat stressed, but we need to have them at the vet. So we actually do mock exams and associate it with positive things, as well as I help teach them to get their nails trimmed happily with the owner. So we counter condition and desensitize the kittens to being on their backs. And then we have, so the owner can cut their nails themselves, which also prevents owners from declawing, which is awesome. We also do harness training. Yes, cats can be harness trained and go out for walks and enjoy outdoors as well. So we'll start doing some harness training. Usually I'll start teaching a target, which is where a kitten follows a target. And you can use that to teach them to go in the carrier, teach them a sit, teach them a spin. So we have a lot of fun with that behavior, because some of my clients get really creative with the homework and they come back and their cat's doing like 5 behaviors, which is super fun. So that's a little bit of what kitten kindergarten is, just a few classes to help expose the kittens to lots of different stimuli in a controlled environment, so I could observe the cats, watch their body language, and keep them below threshold, so they're not showing a lot of signs of stress or anxiety, and we can keep those experiences really positive.
That sounds absolutely amazing. I love the idea of setting up the different stations to work on different things. Do you actually have a Facebook page where people can perhaps see any, I don't know, maybe some photos or video footage of what you're doing?
Yeah, so Chirrups and Chatter has a Facebook page, and then also I work with a lot of shelters because I lecture at conferences around the U.S. and I have a lot of really great resources. If that's something as a shelter or a veterinary clinic you are interested in starting, I have a lot of really great resources and waivers and all that fun stuff that's involved. And I am happy to help get you started. So they can definitely check out my Facebook page, because I post a lot of kitten kindergarten related and kitten socialization related things. Or they can also email me, which is just chirrupsandchatter@gmail.com. And I'd be happy to share that information, because I really think kitten kindergarten has been around for quite a long time. But unfortunately, it's not as popular as I would think it would be, because if these kittens don't have the tools to survive in the world, as far as being exposed to different things like that, these kittens are going to have behavioral issues, which then result in being relinquished to a shelter or being euthanized, or again, the client's just opening the door. And kittens, like, we also teach medication training in kitten kindergarten. So my cats, for example, I say meds, they go to a place and they open their mouth. And as a veterinary technician, I know how life-changing that is, because I know clients who can't give their cats medications. And due to that, their cat leaves the world sooner than they planned. And doing medication training is such an easy thing, especially when they're young kittens. And like, my cat had a dental recently, and I'm not gonna lie, with my own pets, I'm a mess. I just forget all of my knowledge, but it was so great, because he was on pain medications, because he had extractions. And I just could say meds, and he just got his meds, and I didn't even have to stress about it. And it was wonderful because I was so stressed about my cat, because of course he had an abnormal EKG. He's okay. But I was so stressed about that. If I had to worry about being stressed about medicating him too, I just couldn't imagine how horrible that would be.
Yeah, absolutely. And as you say, so many people would be very stressed about giving the medication, as would their cats about receiving it. So yeah, that's right. Fantastic. I actually think that's something that we should be doing with dogs as well. I know it is something that I personally do, and many people work on it, and it does make a massive difference. Introducing in a socialization class, as you say, in either a puppy class or a kitten kindergarten, things like different components, to be honest, of husbandry and of veterinary care, I think are absolutely essential. You know, maybe not done at the vets, but actually in the class, it may not be at a vets, is what I'm saying. But we can still all do this, or you can do it at home. I do think it's really important. So thank you for that. That I do think that is super important. And also thank you for saying that people can reach out to you via email as well, because I think, you know, that's a great resource. It's a great thing that somebody who's already, you know, maybe they're working in a vet, maybe they are the main veterinarian, or they're a technician, or maybe a trainer working with a vet, or just a member of the public who's concerned about lack of socialization. I think it would be great to get more of these programs implemented. So thank you for that, Tabitha.
Right. I am looking forward to a day that kitten kindergarten is as common as puppy socialization, and I will keep screaming it from the rooftops to raise awareness, because like I tell a lot of my clients, their cats are fearful when people come out. That's not normal cat behavior. Cats are very inquisitive and like to check new things out. But if they haven't been socialized, I totally understand. Yes, please hide, because hiding is a natural coping mechanism for cats. But I want them to be happy to see me and greet me at the door and not feel fearful or get cystitis, which is a really painful inflammation of the bladder that we commonly see in cats. And there's a lot of research to say that that's related to stress. And I know clients that travel and then their cat gets cystitis. And if we got them familiar with traveling and with their owners leaving and all these other, just set them up for success with socialization, a lot of these things would be completely preventable. And we all want our cats to be more comfortable and less stressed. None of us like to see our cats really stressed out, but a lot of people, honestly, my clients are amazing. A lot of them didn't even realize that kitten socialization was a thing, or clicker training cats is a thing. So just getting it out, even on this podcast and around, is a huge step forward.
Definitely. As you say, as always, I think we have, I'm going to say a lack of information. The information is actually out there, as you said, but if people don't know where to find it and they're not looking, they're not seeing the information, they're not hearing about it, for example, in their veterinary office, etc., then they're not aware of it and they don't know. I know, I've shared a few videos of cats and actually rabbits being clicker trained, and people are just like, oh my God, wow, you can train a cat. Wow, you can train a rabbit. And it's like, yeah. But people are genuinely surprised.
Yeah, I think that's and usually I tell, if I'm speaking at a lecture or doing a general public lecture, I'm like, you don't have to have my background. You do not have to do what I do. But if you can just start sharing that cats can learn and stop sharing those memes, because I love my cat people, but my cat people are the people that are, you know, really throwing out these negative stereotypes about cats, like they're a-holes or they're mysterious, like all these things that unfortunately they result in cats losing their lives. And we need to start saying, like, your cat's not just being stubborn. That's not a thing. The client, like, your cat's not being spiteful or angry, because you hear that way more about cats than you do any other species. And I don't think it's funny. And I know I'm kind of a killjoy, but I see the results of those memes and the results of those stereotypes. So just sharing with your friends, even as a dog trainer, just sharing at the dog visit that you're at, and you see the dog chasing the cat, saying, hey, actually, that's not normal. Just saying that is a huge step in the right direction. And saying, hey, we can teach your cat some things as well. Or here's a resource, because I'm not familiar with training cats. Here's a resource because your dog chasing the cat is not normal. Like the things I've seen in as a dog trainer in homes with cats, and I mentioned the cat things, and the owners, they're wonderful, but they're like, that's normal. I'm like, no, it's not actually. And just bringing that up, thankfully I train cats as well, but just bringing that up kind of opens their mind. And now in the future, they're going to really consider their cat's needs way more than they did before.
Right. And let's face it, people don't usually take animals into their home with any other intention than having that animal as part of their family, whether it be a dog or a cat or right. a rabbit. They don't intentionally mean to cause that animal either fear or let's say any negative impact on them, either physically or mentally. But it does occur just because of this lack of education, doesn't it? This lack of knowledge and all this misunderstanding that's out there.
Right. I see that, because again, the clients and the people I meet are amazing. They love their cats so much, but they just didn't realize a lot of every client behavior consult I see, no matter what the issue is, they get carrier training and medication training. And even if the client doesn't think it's as important as it is, I'm like, I understand I'm seeing your cat for biting you, or I'm seeing your cat for peeing out of the box. But these things are really important and they're really easy to teach. And I talk about the value of vet visits and the value of, hey, I can help your cat enjoy nail trends. And these are things they didn't know were possible. And when they find out, they're so excited to learn more about it. So it's been great. I've gotten a lot of really positive feedback. And when it comes to kitten kindergarten, I mean, I had 4 classes last year, which was huge, because I have realistic expectations, and I had a full class, and that's awesome. And more cat behavior professionals and veterinary professionals, I am seeing kitten kindergarten talked about more and more and more. So we just need to keep it up.
That's fantastic. That's really nice to hear. And before we finish, Tabitha, can I just ask you, do you have any, maybe a couple of tips that you can give out to help kittens go from hissing to purring?
So if I had to do a
couple
quick,
of main tips, I know you've said quite a few things, but yeah.
And like you mentioned, in that lecture that's coming up, in that webinar, I'll be going in depth with all this stuff, but usually I tell the people I'm working with to set up a comfortable environment. So set up a sanctuary room away from your other animals. Do your best to make that environment comfortable from a cat's perspective. Like, for example, feel away, because cats communicate via scent a lot. Feel away is a pheromone that can just be plugged into the room. Having night lights in the room. So every time you come in, you're not turning on a bright, huge light, especially for a fearful kitten. That can be a lot of stimuli, but I also can't have my clients falling. So night lights are great. Providing lots of resting places. And then when it comes to coming up with a behavior modification plan to go forward, we're going to make a plan. We're going to write out a plan and we're going to have small steps. And then we can collect data as we go. Like, oh, she's doing great with play. So now we're going to proceed with teaching her target now that she's comfortable, that kitten, for example, with me being in front of her, because that might have been too much specifically for that kitten. So that's the other thing. Going at a pace the kitten is comfortable with is huge, and keeping the kitten below threshold. So if you are someone that fosters kittens because you're an amazing person or works with kittens a lot, please, 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 the biggest thing I can recommend is learning all you possibly can about body language, because I know a lot of us feel we are comfortable with body language, but I'll be honest, as a veterinary technician, I learned basically nothing about body language. So as you can imagine, in most shelter settings and most of the general public, they aren't learning it either. So a lot of us only recognize the cat scratching or growling or biting, which is, we call it the ladder of aggression, but that's at the tippy top when these kittens are giving us so other many signs to say, this was too much. You're flooding me. This is way too much. And if we don't recognize them saying, please stop, I always quote Chirag Patel, but he's like, we need to make sure to listen to the whispers so our animals don't need to scream, which is more of the growling and the biting. And that's just perfectly worded. So the biggest tip I can say, I know it, everyone's like, body language is boring, but every time I do my feline communication lecture, people are like, I know a lot about cats. And then they watch that lecture and they're like, so I didn't know much about cats. And that's okay. We should always be learning and improving on what we're doing. So the biggest thing is, I would say, is go at a pace the kitten's comfortable with, keep them below thresholds, and create a comfortable environment.
Thank you, Tabitha. That's absolutely fantastic. Brilliant way to end the show. Thank you so much for joining us. Even without watching, listening to the webinar, people have got some fantastic tips. I am, however, going to say, please don't forget to register for Tabitha's webinar from Hiss to Purr, Keeping Kittens in Lifelong Loving Homes. And that's on September the 3rd. If you go along to the Pet Professional Guild website, so www.petprofessionalguild.com, you can go to the webinar page and you'll find Tabitha's webinar there. So please sign up for that live webinar, because there is going to be obviously a lot more information. Tabitha, many, many thanks for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me and raising awareness about kitten socialization. Reminder to everyone, kittens need socialization too.
Thank you, Tabitha. That's excellent. Yeah, massive reminder there. Kittens need socialization too. Thank you. And our next BARKS podcast, guess what? We're going to be talking more about cats. It's on September 25th, and we'll be chatting cats, kids, and compassion with guest Amy C. Martin. So we look forward to joining you on that show. And from myself and Rebecca King is behind the scenes, we'd like to wish everybody a very enjoyable rest of the day. And you too, Tabitha, thank you again.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you.